Important thing you did for us is to us to love the Lord.
Yes.
We will keep pursuing the Lord.
Yeah.
You will see us soon, I think.
seated. On behalf of the family, Otto Reimer's family, I would just like to welcome you all here this afternoon and to thank you for coming. For many of you, you have come quite a long distance, some from Belize, some from Manitoba, I know, and perhaps from a number of other places as well. So it's good that we could all be together this afternoon. I just wonder if we could have two or three brothers just to stand and pray, not for our brother, but for those of us who are left behind, and for the Lord's going on in us. Amen.
Lord Jesus, Lord, we have no words to say from our mouth, but Lord, we pray your prayer back to you in your word.
Amen.
Blessed are those who mourn,
amen,
for they shall be comforted.
Amen.
Lord, even though we mourn this afternoon,
amen,
we are also filled with hope.
Amen.
Lord, you are the one who can comfort us.
Amen.
Lord, thank you we can come to you.
Amen.
Lord Jesus,
amen,
you're so near us.
Amen.
You're always helping us.
Amen.
You're always watching us.
Amen.
And this afternoon, you're also sustaining us.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Lord, thank you.
Amen.
Thank you for your presence.
Amen.
Thank you we can have you.
Amen.
Lord, we just open to you.
Amen.
Lord, to be strengthened into our inner man.
Amen.
Lord, just to love you more.
Amen.
Lord, we thank you. You are our comfort.
Amen.
You are our everything.
Amen.
Lord, we just open to you.
Amen.
Lord, flood us.
Amen.
Oh, just to love you more.
Amen.
To be one with you.
Amen.
Thank you for this gathering.
Amen.
Thank you for everyone.
Amen.
Oh, Lord Jesus.
Amen. 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 Lord, we praise you.
Amen.
And thank you for our brother.
Amen.
And for his testimony.
Amen.
Lord, we thank you for your life.
Amen.
That you have made yourself so available to us.
Amen.
Lord, thank you that you meet all of our needs.
Amen.
Lord, and you desire to be everything to us.
Amen.
In all of our living.
Amen.
Lord, we give this time to you this afternoon.
Amen.
That your name would be glorified.
Amen.
Oh, Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Lord, we pray for the family.
Amen.
That you would continue to supply them and comfort them.
Amen.
That you would shepherd them in the days ahead.
Amen.
Lord, that they would know you in a deeper way.
Amen.
Amen. I think with your with your hand up, you were given a printed hymn, and the first one and we'd like to sing number, I guess the one on the first page. Well, actually, you can tell which is the first page. But drink a river pure and clear that's flowing from the throne.
Christ our tree and Christ our fruits to be enjoyed therein. Christ our day and Christ our light and Christ our morning star. Christ our everything. To come, oh, to come, the Spirit and the Bride. To come, oh, to come, let him that heareth cry. To come, oh, to come, let him who thirsts and will take freely the water of life. We are washing all our robes, a tree of life to thee. Oh Lord, amen, hallelujah, Jesus is so sweet. We are spirits exercised and thus experience Christ. What a Christ have we. To come, oh, do come, the Spirit and the Bride. Do come, let him that heareth cry. Do come, let him who thirsts and will take freely the water of life. Now we have a hope so bright that outshines the sun, where the brothers all unite and truly are one. Jesus gets us all together, him we now display in the local church. Do come, oh, do come, the Spirit and the Bride. Do come, oh, do come, let him that heareth cry. Do come, oh, do come, let him who thirsts and will take freely the water of life. Is my shepherd forever. He maketh me down to lie. He leads me beside the still waters. Oh, how he does satisfy. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And I shall feast at the table spread for me. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Shepherd himself is my pasture, my shepherd the waters of rest. I eat of his riches in spirit, I drink and oh how I am blessed. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I shall feast at the table spread for me. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. My shepherd, my soul is restoring, my will and emotion and mind. And though through the valley I'm walking, oh, what a companion I find. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And I shall feast days of my life. The table prepared by my shepherd, I feast on and Satan destroy. My head is anointed with oil, my cup runneth over with joy. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I shall feast at the table spread for me. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And now in his house I am dwelling, enjoying the goodness of God. My pleasure is far beyond telling, my pleasure is Jesus my Lord. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever, and I shall feast at the table spread for me. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
Well, this afternoon we have four brothers who will just share a brief word, not necessarily concerning our brother Otto, but something from the Lord's Word. When I was asked to speak something, it was suggested that I share something concerning the matter of the kingdom. I think when I was first asked, the first thing that came to my mind was not so much related to the matter of the kingdom, but rather it was a verse from Genesis chapter 4. And I felt that this verse in Genesis chapter 4 expressed something of a description of our brother Otto. And of course, it was related to his whole life. We could turn to Genesis 4:26, and I'll just read the verse. And to Seth also a son was born, and he called his name Enosh. At that time, men began to call upon the name of Jehovah. So I thought of Enosh when I was asked to speak concerning, or at least for this occasion, because I felt that, if you look at the meaning of the word Enosh, I looked it up in several different places, but Enosh essentially means frail, mortal man. And I think particularly in the last few years of his life, we could see that our brother Otto physically was frail, a frail, mortal man, and he was anticipating the end of his life. But inwardly, he also recognized that he was a frail, mortal man. And as a frail mortal man, you know, as in Genesis chapter 4, then began men to call upon the name of the Lord. And surely our brother was one who recognized his need, he recognized his weakness, and he recognized his need to call on the name of the Lord. And so he was one who called. I think he called much. You know, I didn't hear him audibly very much when I went to visit. But when I would go to visit him, he always had a verse or two verses. He wouldn't tell me that they were verses. Here, I want to share with you a verse. He simply repeated the verses. These were verses that he had enjoyed and appreciated. So he was one who loved the Lord, who had a heart for the Lord, who loved the Lord's word, and was one who also spontaneously spoke the Lord's word. Even out of his weakness, you know, in his, I don't know that much about the details of his whole life, but I know that he certainly had an awareness, an appreciation of his weakness, of his failure, and then of the Lord's forgiveness, of the cleansing of the Lord's blood, and of his standing before God. But not because of anything that he had done, anything that he had accomplished, but it was all together because of what the Lord had done and what the Lord was doing in him. You know, another verse that I was considering is from Matthew chapter 5, verse 3. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. So there's the word kingdom. You know, blessed are the poor in spirit. And essentially, for one to be poor in spirit does not mean that he has a poor spirit, but rather that he is one who is empty and open and ready to receive something of the Lord. You know, I really only have known Otto in a more detailed way, a more personal way in the last I would say four or five years. And during that time, I also realized that he was one who was open and empty. And by that I mean not that he was devoid of any content, but he was empty and open to receive something from the Lord. He was not one who would boastfully speak concerning his accomplishments, concerning the things that he had been involved in, the things that he had done. He didn't boast of anything of himself, but he was one whose boast was really in the Lord, and whose desire was that the Lord would fill him, and even that he would be, he would have a measure of transformation in order that he would be one prepared, prepared for the Lord's kingdom. Lord Jesus. Well, I don't want to take the other brother's time, so maybe Simon should go ahead and share something. Maybe it's easier to come here because I think everything is being recorded.
Jesus, continue to surprise the family of our brothers Otto. Serve them. In the Old Testament, King Solomon said, a time to be born and a time to die. Who controls the time? Who controls how long we will live? who know what will happen the coming week, the coming day, even coming hours. Solomon realized under the sun nothing is new, nothing is everlasting. Everything is vanity of vanity. All is vanity. My impression about Father Otto, he had a physical help since I met him. But he tried his best to attend the meeting every last day. Just a few days after he had surgery, I saw him in the meeting. I came to him, said, "Hi, Mother's Otto. Nice to see you here." He looked at me, smiled, and said he was happy to be in the meeting with the saints. Because his disease, he was weak. In the meeting, he will not be able to do so many things. He will not sing so loud. He will just listen to our singing, our calling, our praying. But he enjoyed. He treasured every time we can experience Christ with the saints. This is the best portion of his life. As Solomon, in his conclusion, he said, "Fear God, keep his commandment. This is hope of man." When we all have this wisdom to gain Christ, to pursue Christ, to enjoy Christ every day in our life. Thank you, Lord.
When we come to the time when someone has departed from us, there may be many responses in us to this event. But I'd like to talk about three. Firstly, we may have a concern. We may have a concern for the one who is gone. Secondly, we may feel the loss ourselves. And thirdly, it may cause us to consider our course, to consider the path of life. So firstly, when we come to, we're here to remember our brother Bob, we can be full of joy on his behalf. As our focus in life is the beautiful person of the Lord himself, so we follow Paul in the book of Philippians, where he considers his death to be his departing to be with the Lord. And based on the redemption that the Lord has obtained, the eternal redemption, and based upon our brother's salvation, we can praise the Lord that he is with him. Although he's departed from us, he is at home with the Lord. Outside the limitations that we have here in our physical body, we can enjoy the Lord to a higher degree. And for this, we praise him. Secondly, we may feel the loss. So although he's at home with the Lord, he's abroad from us. And we miss all that he is to us, whether as a husband or a father. or as a beloved member of the Lord's body. We feel the loss because we're here. We're here in space and time, and so we feel the loss. But in this loss, the God of all comfort is operating to comfort us in our affliction. And in this comforting, He works out something in us so that with that same comfort with which we've been comforted, we are able to comfort. And so here we are together in this mutual comforting that the God of all comfort is working out among us. So on the one hand, we're so sorry that our brother is gone. On the other hand, we're so happy to be here with him in this comfort, in this mutual comfort. What a comfort. The God of all comfort operating in mutuality in his body to comfort us in every kind of affliction. So praise the Lord for this operation. And thirdly, when we are faced with the mortality of one of our loved ones, it can cause us also to turn and consider our own days. In Psalm 90, Moses, after praising the Lord for his eternalness, had this to say concerning man, that our days, our years are 70, if we're strong, 80. And this kind of consideration causes us to number our days. Each day in God's economy is a day of value, because in each day, God can work out something eternal in the midst of that day. So here we are, as frail mortal men, with a very short time span, but at the same time, what is being worked out in the lives of these mortal men is something eternal, an eternal weight of glory. So praise the Lord for this. Praise the Lord for what He's carrying out among us. Praise the Lord for His economy that we can experience day by day. So here, I hope that the Lord would soften every heart, that the Lord would open us all, that we'd be open to what He's doing in us, His economy He's carrying out, His purpose to dispense Himself day by day into our being, that in this mortal body, even our mortal body, even our brother's mortal body, the life of Jesus would be manifest. God's intention is not simply for us to live a good life, to be highly praised at the end, but His intention is that day by day He would work Himself in all of His riches into every part of our being, that there would be a testimony in this universe that there are mortal men living out the life of eternity in their daily life. Amen. So may the Lord impress us all, and may we all be blessed with such a turn, that we would turn and be open day by day to be under His dispensing. And may in such a way this death cause the resurrection life to be released.
I will just read a couple of verses. And this first one, my father-in-law has read to me, and we discussed it. For we don't live for ourselves or die for ourselves. If we live, it's to honor the Lord. And if we die, it's to honor the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. That was Romans 14, verse 7 and 8. 1 John 5, verse 1, another one. Everyone that believes that Jesus is the Christ has become a child of God. tremendous truth in that one. What does it mean to believe? John 7, verse 37 and 38. As Jesus was on the fast and shouted to the crowds, "Anyone who is thirsty may come to me. Anyone who believes in me may come and drink. For the scriptures declare, rivers of living water will flow from his heart." It tells us here, anyone who is thirsty may come. Are we seekers? My father-in-law has so often encouraged people to be seekers. Are we thirsty? Thirsty to believe. Thirsty to drink. Then we'll have rivers of living water will flow from our hearts. Hebrews 10 verse 10. This is God's will for us. For God's will was for us to be made holy by the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all time. To be holy. God has made us. He has sacrificed himself, his body, that we will be holy. I'm so glad that we can be part of that, that we can be holy, we can be saints, we can be healed once for all time. After this, we will, Hertha, oldest daughter, will come in there and read the life story of her dad. Short one, very short. And then we will have, right after that, will be a video tribute of remembrance. And I don't know how clear it will be, since the house is so full for everyone to see, but I can tell you we plan to show it at a meeting hall later on again, and then we will open up mic to share our tributes as well there, just to prepare yourself, and if you don't see everything here, we hope to see it there again.
Good afternoon. I want to read the life story of my dad, and this is written by my mom. So the life story of my husband, Otto Reimer, loving father and grandfather. "For I am already being poured out, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, with which the Lord, the righteous judge, will recompense me in that day, and not only me, but also all those who have loved his appearing." 2 Timothy 4, verse 6 to 8. Otto was born on January 25, 1951 in Mexico. His happy parents were Cornelius and Susanna Reimer. He was the youngest of 13 children. When he was 8 years old, two major life-changing events happened. His dad passed away quite suddenly, and soon after that, his family moved to Belize, Central America, as starting a new life in the jungle. His oldest brother, John, took it upon himself to be the father figure for young Otto. When he finished school at the age of 14, he started working for his brother, John, in the feed mill. At a young age, he accepted the Lord as his personal Savior and Lord. As he gained more life experience and the years passed by, he grew to love the Lord deeply. He found deep joy in sitting with his brothers and sisters in the Lord, together enjoying the Lord. Another deep joy for him was to see his children and grandchildren love the Lord too. On September 12, 1971, we stood before the Lord, family and friends, and promised each other our love and commitment for as long as we both lived. The Lord blessed us with 9 precious children and 44 years of shared life, consisting of both happiness and trials. His working and career years in Belize involved working in the feed mill, trucking, being the owner of the feed mill, teaching school, serving in different community committees, being a tour guide for the community and crop farming. A major change in our life in our lives came about in 2005 when we moved to Calgary, Alberta. Here he owned a trucking company with his sons. He was a strong, healthy man until he was diagnosed with diabetes in 1996. His health declined slowly after that. In the beginning of last year, 2015, he was diagnosed with cancer as well. His battle with cancer ended when he went home to be with the Lord on January 16, 2016. He will be missed dearly by me, his wife, Agnes, and our children, Herta and Abe Duick, Betty and Walter Thiessen, Peter and Alba Reimer, Cornelius and Suyapita Reimer, Tina and Stanley Reimer, Sharon and Henry Reimer, Rosalind Reimer, Gerald and Janice Reimer, Carolyn Reimer, and 31 grandchildren. We rejoice with him that he is enjoying the Lord face to face. The family wishes to express their gratitude to everyone who prayed for us and Dad and friends who brought meals, all who showed their love and support, and the medical staff of the hospitals and health care centers who cared for Dad, the Water Grove Neighborhood and Bereavement Committee, and Pearson's Funeral Home. Thank you.
please. Hello. Follow me.
You and we thank you for what you are. Praise you, Lord Jesus.
behalf of the family, we do thank each of you for joining us here today. The family has planned a reception to follow at 99 Alder Lake Boulevard at the clubhouse. Please feel free to make your way there to join the family. On behalf of the Pearsons, we do thank you for this opportunity to be here.